Today we're going to talk about the gross anatomy of the nervous system, specifically the central nervous system. And the gross anatomy is the things that you can just see with your naked eye. And so the central nervous system consists of the brain and the spinal cord. And there are some subdivisions within the brain itself. We have our brain stem and our cerebellum. By convention, the dorsal aspect of the central nervous system in the spinal cord is the back. Think of yourself as a dolphin. If you had a dorsal fin, it would be coming out of your back, and that's the dorsal side. And so the opposite of dorsal is ventral, and that's your tummy side. And so that is the convention that we think about when we're thinking about the central nervous system, especially the spinal cord. This is a section of a brain. This is a whole brain. And this is the anterior or frontal pole of the brain. This is the posterior or caudal pole, caudal meaning tail. And so if your brain had a tail, it'd be on this end. And again, the brain, as you'll note, maybe it's obvious from this, this is the brainstem leading into the spinal cord. And you can see how this is at an almost a right angle with the rest of the brain. So what was dorsal here in the spinal cord is now up. And what was ventral is now down. So the dorsal part of the brain is the top towards the crown of your head, and the ventral part of your brain is the part more towards the base of your skull. So important landmarks that you can see within the brain, just right on the side, really grossly, things that were described very early on, are things like the lateral fissure, which runs right here. Let me draw that in for you. Lateral fissure. The lateral fissure separates your frontal lobe from your temporal lobe. Another important landmark that we can see here is called the central sulcus, and it runs here. This is hard to do, but I'm working on it. There we go. There's the central sulcus. Just anterior or in front of the central sulcus is the pre-central gyrus, and just behind it or posterior to it is the post-central gyrus. These two gyri are very important when we're talking about your primary motor systems and your primary sensory systems. The neurons that actually control movement live right in this gyrus. And the neurons that are responsible for your body map on your brain, so knowing exactly where that mosquito bit you, live right here in this post-central gyrus. The other areas of the brain that you can see are the parietal lobe here, and most caudally is the occipital lobe. Okay, there's not a real clear landmark between parietal and occipital on the lateral side of the brain, but there's a very clear landmark on the medial surface, and I'll show you that in a minute. We can also still see our cerebellum and our brainstem. As you'll note on this lateral surface of the brain, it's thrown into a bunch of folds. The bumps are called gyri, and the folds in between them are called sulci. The reason your brain has this appearance is basically your brain is too big for your head. And the only way we could fit your brain inside your head was to fold it up. And so this gives us this appearance of all of these folds and bumps. Again, we have the central sulcus here. Whoa, here. And our lateral fissure here. We also have another landmark that you can see here, which is called the preoccipital notch. And this is a boundary between our temporal and our occipital lobes. So the lateral fissure, central sulcus, preoccipital notch are all important landmarks on the lateral surface of the brain. So as you know, your brain has two hemispheres, a right and a left. They're separated by a structure right down the middle called the superior longitudinal sulcus, also known as the longitudinal fissure, and it runs right here. Sorry, that's a little bit off, but you get the idea. It's right in this zone. And this is the division then between your left and your right hemispheres. Your brain is divided into six functional lobes: the frontal lobe, the temporal lobe, and then just posterior to that central sulcus is our parietal lobe, and all the way in the back is our occipital lobe. We have another lobe that's buried. If you look here at the lateral sulcus, or lateral fissure, if we pried that open and removed some of this brain, you'd see that there's even more brain deep to this structure. This buried lobe, or island lobe, is referred to as the insula. If we cut the brain in half and look at the medial surface, so this is the medial surface of the left hemisphere, again, we can see our frontal lobe and our parietal lobe. We can see our occipital lobe. Here's the cerebellum. Here's the brainstem. And just peeking out from underneath from the opposite side is our temporal lobe right here. The paracentral lobule is this section of brain up here where our pre- and postcentral gyri kind of come over from over the lateral surface onto the medial aspect of the brain. The parieto-occipital sulcus here, this very deep groove here, is that clear landmark I referred to earlier that separates our parietal and our occipital lobes. Some other important structures we can see is this big fiber tract here. This is the corpus callosum. And this large white matter fiber tract is literally how your right hand knows what your left hand is doing. This fiber band connects all of the neurons from one hemisphere to the other. Another important part of the brain is the diencephalon. And when we talk about autonomics and when we talk about sensory systems, so it's this kind of lump here in the middle. This is gray matter that's deep within the brain. It's old. It's very old. It's so old that it doesn't have any layers. It's not part of the cortex, but it's kind of continuous with your brainstem. You can also see the brainstem here and the cerebellum. So again, the lobes that you can see from the medial surface of the brain are the frontal, the parietal, and the occipital. One other lobe is a lobe that is more functional than structural in the sense that it crosses the boundaries of our frontal, parietal, and temporal lobes. In this section of the brain, we've removed the diencephalon, we've removed the brainstem and the cerebellum. And what we can see here is the cingulate gyrus, which runs right around the top of the corpus callosum. It's set off from the rest of the cortex by the cingulate sulcus, which I'll try to trace here. So it kind of goes around that way. So this is the cingulate sulcus, and then this is the cingulate gyrus. It continues, the limbic lobe continues into the temporal lobe, and we follow our collateral sulcus around underneath the temporal lobe. And the internal boundary of that is our parahippocampal gyrus. So the parahippocampal gyrus combined with the cingulate gyrus forms your limbic lobe. And as you can see, this kind of makes a half circle, or almost a complete circle, which in Latin is a limbus, hence we call it the limbic lobe. So the functions of your lobes. So we have six lobes, and they all have slightly different functions. Your frontal lobe is mainly concerned with executive functions. It's where your personality is. It's where your decision-making takes place. The parietal lobe, precentral or the postcentral gyrus, is your primary sensory cortex, and there's a lot of association cortex in the parietal lobe as well. The temporal lobe is your primary auditory cortex. That is quite literally where you hear. You may have all kinds of vibrations coming into the ear, but you don't really hear them until those signals reach your temporal cortex. The same for the occipital cortex. It's your primary visual cortex, and you may have perfectly working eyes, but if somebody comes along and scoops out your occipital lobe, you can't see. So primary visual cortex is in the occipital lobe. The insula, we're pretty sure it has a lot to do with pain processing, and it receives a lot of input from the sensations associated with your viscera, i.e. your hollow organs, your intestines and your heart and things like that. The limbic system has a lot to do with emotion. Arousal, just meaning like you're paying attention to your environment, you're aroused, interested. motivation. What motivates you to get up and go and conduct the business of every day is part of your limbic system. And memory. The hippocampus is just deep to that parahippocampal gyrus, and it has a primary function in memory. In summary, what I really want you to remember from this particular lecture are how many lobes and what are their names. What are the landmarks, the gyri or the sulci, or what other landmarks did I mention that separate these lobes so you can tell where one starts and the other stops? And then what are the functions associated with each of these lobes? If you understand all of the answers to these questions, then you'll do very well on the quiz.